O God, whose nature is always to forgive and to show mercy, we humbly implore you for your servant Anthony, whom you have called to journey to you. And since he hopes to believe in you, grant that he may be led to our true homeland, to delight in its everlasting joys. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Please be seated for our readings.
A reading from the Book of Wisdom. The souls of the just are in the hand of God, and no torment shall touch them. They seemed, in the view of the foolish, to be dead. And their passing away was thought an affliction, and their going forth from us utter destruction. But they are in peace. For if before others indeed they be punished, yet is their hope full of immortality. Chastised a little, they shall be greatly blessed, because God tried them and found them worthy of himself. As gold in the furnace, he proved them, and as sacrificial offering, he took them as himself. Those who trust in him shall understand truth, and the faithful shall abide with him in love. Because grace and mercy are with his holy ones, and his care is with his elect. The word of the Lord.
I reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, if God is for us, who can be against us? He did not spare his own son, but handed him over for us all. Will he not also give us everything else along with him? Who will bring a charge against God's chosen ones? It is God who acquits us. Who will condemn? It is Christ Jesus who died, rather was raised, who also is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. What will separate us from the love of Christ? Will anguish or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or the sword? No, in all these things we conquer overwhelmingly through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life nor angels nor principalities nor present things nor future things nor powers nor height nor depth nor any other creature we will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. You have faith in God, have faith also in me. In my Father's house, there are many dwelling places. If there were not, but I have told you that I am going to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back again and take you to myself, so that where I am, you also may be. Where I am going, you know the way." Thomas said to him, "Master, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." The Gospel of the Lord. We are here this morning, my dear sisters and brothers, to offer our prayers for the eternal repose of Anthony. One of the precious gifts, if not the most precious gift that we have received from God, is the gift of life. And this gift of life enables us to venture the world, create memories, build relationships, relationship with God and with one another. This gift of life enables us to see the beauty of creation, how beautiful it is, the creation that was made, that was created by God Himself. And this gift of life, my dear sisters and brothers, is so unique and mysterious. Unlike any other gift that we have received or we may receive in this world. Because as we have received this gift of life from God, there will come a time that this very gift of life that we once received, we're going to offer it back, bring it back to God. But when we offer it back to God, my dear sisters and brothers, this gift is now filled with memories. Memories with our loved ones, their family members, the relationships that we have built, families, happy memories, all the ups and downs of our life, we offer and bring it back to God. And this is what makes this life so unique and mysterious and yet so beautiful, because as we have received it from God, almost as if it is empty, now it is filled with so many things, and most especially our faith in Jesus Christ. But of course, my dear sisters and brothers, as we bring this gift of life back to God, there will be sadness, there will be sorrow, there will be pain, especially of a passing of a loved one, a family member, a relative, a loved one. But Jesus Christ gives us hope, and he gives us his promise of eternal life. And if that promise of eternal life is not enough for us, Jesus Christ gives us the words of healing, of comfort, of consolation, of support. And if those words are not yet enough, Jesus Christ tells us in our gospel reading from the Gospel of John that he prepared a dwelling place for each and every one of us, a dwelling place where we can find pure joy, lasting peace, no more pain, no more suffering, where we will enjoy the kingdom of God, life that is eternal with God, where we join the heavenly family of God. And if those words are not enough, my dear sisters and brothers, Jesus Christ himself tells us, I will come back again and take you to myself, so that where I am, you also may be. And so this gives us hope and assurance, for we have a God who does not abandon us, who does not leave us, but we have a God who is love, who is loving, merciful, and just. A God who always and will always be there for us, who will walk with us, even as the psalm says, we walk in the dark valley of darkness. We will fear no evil, for we have God at our side. And so, my dear sisters and brothers, as we offer our prayers for the eternal repose of Anthony, we support each other as one family of God. Because now, Anthony will offer all the memories that you shared with him to God. He will bring all these memories to that dwelling place that God has prepared for him. But as he brings these memories to that dwelling place, an eternal dwelling place with God, he also puts them in your hearts so that you may treasure them, so that you may never forget them, so that it may increase your faith, so that it may help you to support each other, console each other, and remind you perhaps of another great gift that God has given to us, a gift of family. Family will always be there for us, no matter what. Centered on the family of Jesus, Mary, and Joseph. And so we pray, my dear sisters and brothers, eternal repose unto the soul of Anthony, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon him. May he rest in peace. Amen. May his soul and all the souls of the faithful departed rest in the peace of Christ. Amen. Please all stand. God the Almighty Father raised Jesus Christ, his Son, from the dead. With confidence we ask him to save all his people, living and dead. I now call again Alexandra and Anne-Marie for our petition. And our response is, Lord, hear our prayer.
For Anthony, who in baptism was given the pledge of eternal life, that he may now be admitted to the company of the saints, we pray to the Lord. For our brother, who ate the body of Christ, the bread of life, that he may be raised upon the last day, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Anthony's deceased relatives and friends, and for all who have helped us through good times and bad,
that they may have the reward of their goodness. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have fallen asleep in the hope of rising again, that they may see God face to face, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For Anthony's family and friends, that as they seek comfort and consolation, they may find healing in their pain, and that the light of Christ will dispel the darkness and doubt that comes from grief, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all of us assembled here to worship in faith, that we may be gathered together in the kingdom of God, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God, our shelter and our strength, you listen in love to the cry of your people. Hear the prayers we offer for our departed brothers and sisters, cleanse them of their sins, and grant them the fullness of redemption. And we ask all these things through Christ our Lord. Please be seated. Pray, my dear sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all of his holy church. As we humbly present to you these sacrificial offerings, O Lord, for the salvation of your servant Anthony, we beseech your mercy, that he who did not doubt your Son to be a loving Savior may find in him a merciful judge who lives and reigns forever and ever. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like a dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Mysterium Fidei. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and David, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember your servant Anthony, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he who was united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection. Remember also our sisters and brothers who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. As one family of God and at the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity, in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Let us pray. Lord God, whose Son left us in the sacrament of his body, food for the journey, mercifully grant that strengthened by it, our brother Anthony may come to the eternal table of Christ, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our brother Anthony. May our farewell express our affection for him. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet him again, when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself. Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our brother Anthony, in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon Anthony in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant, and help us to remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our brother Anthony forever. And we ask this through Christ our Lord. In peace, let us take our brother Anthony to his place of rest.
First of all, I want to thank everyone for coming today. I know how much so many of you meant to my grandpa and how grateful he is that you are all here. And second of all, I know what many of you are wondering. Yes, I'm the one that's a lawyer. And yes, it is a big deal. I pass the bar on everything. And I'm not trying to brag about it, but I know my grandpa would want me to tell you because he really liked to brag about it. Over the last few days, my family has received condolences through visits, phone calls, texts, and Facebook comments. So many Facebook comments. And there has been a recurring theme throughout all of them. So many people, from childhood friends of my mom, my aunt, and my uncles, to people who met Grandpa only a few times, mentioned that he always made them feel welcome, both in his family and at his house. The word intimidating has been thrown around to describe Grandpa, and it's true. Anyone who knows him will tell you that he could just look at you a certain way and you would shut right up. But if you truly got to know him, you knew that he was incredibly warm and inviting. He was quick to offer you a drink or a plate of food. He loved being surrounded by family and friends, and he never minded when we had to squeeze together at the dinner table so extra place settings could be added. There was nothing that made him happier than hosting a house full of people down the shore. He especially loved when Uncle Joe and Uncle Freddie would come down with their families, and we would all get to be together for the weekend. Truthfully, I think he mostly liked to have his second set of grandchildren around. Having Jenna, Jillian, Gianna, Freddie, and John Marco at the shore house made everything 5 times louder, although that was mostly Uncle Freddie, and 5 times more hectic. And that was just the way Grandpa liked it. He especially loved when they came down because he loved to bust John Marco's chops despite their 70-year age difference. It didn't matter to Grandpa how many air mattresses had to be inflated or how many dozens of bagels had to be bought in the morning. He knew how much everyone enjoyed being down the shore, and he was always at his happiest when the people around him were happy. There is no one for whom that is truer than his grandchildren. Our grandpa was made to be a grandfather. He lived to give his grandchildren everything we wanted in life. And all he asked in return was that we work hard and become the best versions of ourselves. I like to believe we did that. As the only grandson, Anthony shared a special bond with Grandpa. Of course, they could talk for hours about the effectiveness of the Rangers special teams combos or every NFL quarterback over the last 20 years. But it went beyond that. Anthony is exactly the man Grandpa taught him to be. He always puts his family first. He is generous and hardworking, and he would do anything for the people he loves. He has all of Grandpa's best qualities passed down to him simply by watching the way Grandpa treated the people around him. And I have all the faith in the world that Anthony will bring these qualities with him throughout the rest of his life, and he will continue to be a reflection of Grandpa every day. I would like to thank Amory, Alexandra, and I are also the women Grandpa taught us to be. He taught us to be strong and independent in a world where that is not always easy. But he wanted nothing more than to see his granddaughters forge their own paths in life. He would tell anyone who would listen that his granddaughter Amory was studying engineering at the University of Michigan, and he loved to see how happy she was in Ann Arbor. But I believe there was nothing he loved more about Amory than the way he laughed when they were together. Over the past few months, Amory was with Grandpa almost every day. Much of the time, she would sit with him while he ate breakfast and watch the news, or watch The Price is Right, or Let's Make a Deal, or the 67 episodes of Family Feud that he had on tape. She would sit with him and just keep cracking jokes like she does. And as much as I gave her a hard time for it, I know how much Grandpa appreciated the fact that she always wanted to make him smile at a time when that wasn't always easy for him. Alexandra is the most dedicated person I know. She has trained as a gymnast for over 16 years, competes for the University of New Hampshire Wildcats, and recently powered through a year-long recovery following ACL surgery. And no one was more impressed by Allie's greatness than Grandpa. He would sit through a 3-hour gymnastics meet just to watch Allie perform for a few minutes, and he was proud of her and happy to do so. Watching Allie do something she loved so much was worth everything to him. Of course, us grandkids would not be here without a few important people. I said earlier that Grandpa was made to be a grandfather, but he didn't get that way overnight. He had a little bit of training as the father of 2 of the 3 strongest women I've ever known, and I'll get to the third one later, but spoiler alert, it's my grandma. You would be hard-pressed to find two people more willing to go above and beyond for their parents than my mother and Aunt Joanne. And that is because Grandma and Grandpa went above and beyond for them their whole lives. Grandpa was the kind of father that always made sure to make time for his daughters. When he brought the Shore House all those years ago, he did so to give his family a place where they could be together during the summer. And even once Mom and Aunt Joanne started their own families, Grandpa was always there for them when they needed him. And they were there for him in return. Whether it was drives to doctor's appointments, grocery trips to buy Grandpa anything he wanted to eat, or just spending time with him, they both juggled full-time jobs and their own families in order to be there for Grandpa as much as possible. They are the embodiment of what it means to be good daughters, and Anne-Marie, Allie, and I are lucky to follow in their footsteps. It's a testament to Grandpa's character that his two son-in-laws were willing to drop anything and everything to be there for him. He treated my dad and Uncle Steve as if they were his own, and I know he wouldn't have done so if he wasn't sure they were the right men for the job. Dad and Uncle Steve are good men to their cores, and Grandpa knew that. He saw that they would do anything for their families, just like Grandpa, and he trusted them with his daughters and grandchildren. Of course, sometimes that came back to bite them, like when Grandpa made them set up a motion-activated ring doorbell at his house, which now goes off every time someone comes within 10 feet of the front door. But I know they would have done it a million more times for Grandpa if he asked. Anyone who knows me will tell you that I'm a pretty cynical person. Despite all my blessings, I tend to have trouble believing in the good things in life. But one thing I've always believed in is soulmates. I know that they exist, and I know that because of my grandparents. I could not have asked for a better example of what it truly means to find the person you are meant to spend your life with. Grandma and Grandpa were not only husband and wife, but best friends. They took trips together to Paris, to Rome, the Bahamas, and Las Vegas, just to name a few, and they loved traveling together. But they were also so happy just sitting on the terrace down the shore, reading and drinking coffee and being with each other. They took care of each other with the type of love and care only a lucky few people ever get to experience. And through almost 54 years of marriage, they chose each other every single day. I only hope one day to have a fraction of the happiness with someone that my grandma and grandpa had with each other. My earliest memory, not only with my grandpa, but ever, is sitting on the couch with him in the cellar of 57th Street. I really loved spending time at that house. It was truly the place I felt most at home in the world, despite the fact that I never actually lived there. Grandpa loved Brooklyn more than anyone. It is the place where he was born, where he and his two younger brothers, my Uncle Louie and my Uncle Frankie, spent many, many years driving Grandma Minnie crazy, where he fell in love with my grandma, and where he raised his children. When my grandparents decided to move to Staten Island, I was upset, and I asked my grandpa why they were leaving Brooklyn. I couldn't imagine why he was so willing to leave the place he had called home for 70 years. First, he told me that he didn't want to leave, and that Grandma was making him, which was not very believable because as much as he loved my grandma, he barely did things he didn't want to do. But after some badgering, he told me the truth, that he wanted to be closer to his family, that he would move to the ends of the earth to spend more time with us. Staten Island didn't have the same memories as 57th Street, but we made new memories, and then we did the same thing when they moved to Jersey last year. It is not uncommon in our family to end a call or a visit with an "I love you," even if you spent over half that phone call or visit arguing. That's just how we are. But I noticed a while ago that whenever I hung up the phone with Grandpa, or I left his house, or he left me a message, he always said some variation of, "I love you, be careful." I never asked him about it or remarked on it, but I always thought about how he added that, "be careful." The closest to an explanation that I came was when I was in London during my junior year of college. I spent a couple of months there studying abroad, as I'm sure many of you know, because I talk about it all the time. And a few weeks after I got there, I was on the phone with Grandpa, and I jokingly told him that I couldn't believe he and Grandma let me go to London. And he became serious and told me how worried they were about me going all the way there on my own. But he knew how important it was to me, and he trusted me to be smart and to be careful. No matter his own worries, he did not want to stop me from living out a dream I had had for most of my teenage years. He just wanted me to be careful. I was incredibly nervous to come up here and speak today. As my sister never fails to tell me, my sense of humor is not for everyone, and that was part of the reason. But I was also afraid that I would not be able to capture the enormity of who my grandpa was. He was an incredibly important person to so many people, and I knew I wouldn't have enough time to say everything I wanted to say. I could have stood up here for the rest of the day and told you all about the wonderful things I knew about my grandpa. But I came up here today, and I talked about what my grandpa meant to me, his oldest grandchild, and what I believed he meant to our family, and I know that would have been enough for him. Grandpa, you were everything our family could have asked for in a patriarch. You adored all of us without limitations. You provided us with the best lives possible, and you pushed us to be the best versions of ourselves. We were lucky to be loved by you up close for so long, and I know we will continue to be loved by you from afar. I love you, Grandpa, and be careful.